Hey, how you doing? This is RJ. So, in one of my recent videos, I talked about an interview with Ta-Nehisi Coates, who is the current writer for Captain America, and how he believes that, well, basically, the police and the military should be defunded, and why this actually should be, and how the subtext of that interview is to link Trump with the police, and to link the idea that because the police should be defunded, because they do nothing but incite violence, so too should Trump not be seen, if he wins come November, he should not be seen in any way as legitimate. He should actually be seen, in the eyes of Coates and what he is describing, as simply a ruler who rules through violence and force. And so, really, he justifies violence against the police while at the same time seeming like he's preaching nonviolence, while at the same time linking that idea of violence against Trump should he win, and he believes he's probably going to win, then that should be justified as well. Now, I'll take that video and the interview that it came from and link those both in the description. But what I just discussed, that is the subtext to this interview with Coates. Today, I want to go over the actual text and how what Coates is saying is a destruction of the idea of hero in itself, and certainly a hero story. And it is a destruction of this because progressives believe themselves to be the peacemakers. So, I'll wait a second so you guys can stop laughing at that. But honestly, this is what progressives actually view themselves as. They view themselves as the peacemakers. And I want to go through Coates' words to show you how this is the case and what this means to any kind of story, but specifically a hero kind of story and specifically a superhero kind of story, which is what I normally talk about. So, in order to do that, at first, I'm going to go back to an older video that I did. It was an interview of Sana Amanat with Ann Nesenti. Ann Nesenti was one of the great writers for Marvel in the 1990s. And in this recent interview with her, Ann Nesenti clearly states that what a comic book is, it's an escalation narrative. The whole thing comes down to a fight. And this is what you have to build up to in order to have a comic book. That is to say, a superhero comic book. And she further stated that women, in her estimation, are not really prepared for this kind of escalation narrative. They have to learn about it, they have to train themselves in order to understand what it's all about. Now, I would completely agree with this summation of what she is saying about a superhero story, and really any hero story at all. Because the traditional idea of a hero for over 3,000 years within Western civilization is a paragon of virtue. And these virtues are set up as larger principles that actually exist within reality. And as they are set up, the negative for these virtues are the vices. And the vices themselves are indeed set up as the negative to the virtues. That is to say, it is the specific turning away from the virtues, or perhaps one virtue in particular, and that itself, that turning away, is the vice. So yes, these vices are the exact opposite of the virtues. Now, I want to do an entire video about this sometime in the near future, hopefully, so I'm just going to go over it briefly here. Your vices are your opposite of your virtues, and a hero is a paragon of virtue. Now, how does this impact story? Well, let's go back to Aristotle, which I usually like to do, because his description of what a story is in Poetics defined for us, for the next 2,000, almost 2,500 years now, what a story actually is. Sometimes it was indirectly, sometimes it was directly, but almost everyone, over the last 2,000 years, 2,400 years, have been using his definition of what a story is in order to create a story. And what he says you have with your characters in a story is you have a hero. And a hero is someone who is more virtuous than you are. And you have a villain, and the villain is someone who is less virtuous than you are, or to put it in a negative way, someone who is more vice-ridden than you are. And you have the common characters, the characters who are the same as you, same as the common man, in relation to virtue and vice. And as he describes it, these common characters are simply background noise. These common characters are not anything within a story that has any significant impact. They are simply there as part of the scenery, as it were. And what the story itself is about, especially a hero story, is the conflict between the hero and the villain. Because, of course, if you have a hero who is a paragon of virtue, and you have a villain who is someone who is steeped in vice, and vice is indeed, as it is defined, the exact opposite and exclusion of virtue, then these two things are mutually exclusive. You can't have virtue and vice existing together. So it comes down to a conflict. And so we go back to Anne Nesenti's words, that yes, indeed, if you're writing a superhero story, it is an escalation narrative and it leads to a fight. It leads to a conflict. Now, just briefly, you had Sana Amanat interviewing Anne Nesenti in this interview. And when Anne Nesenti said those words, Sana Amanat said, "I agree," and then went on to talk for a couple of more sentences showing the fact that A, she didn't understand what Anne Nesenti was saying at all, and or she completely disagreed with this idea that a superhero story leads to a conflict. And, by the way, this also leads to a rejection of the idea of a pathos. Because, not always, but I would say to a great extent, your pathos also comes down to this conflict. You have, let's look at someone like Spider-Man or Batman. You have characters which were inserted into a conflict. A conflict between good and evil happened, and in that moment, evil triumphed over good. And so these characters, they saw this, and within their lives, it promoted them to cling to virtue even more tightly than anyone else around them. And so, being this person who clings to virtue, they became a paragon of virtue, which then transformed them into a hero. But again, this comes down to a conflict and the necessity of this conflict between good and evil. But one of the things that Sana Amanat, who is the vice president and director of content and character development at Marvel Comics, she actually brags about the fact that she excludes pathos from the newer characters, these new progressive characters that they are creating. They want that out completely, and she makes sure that it is out completely. Why? I would say because, again, she does not believe that a superhero comic is something that leads to a conflict, like Anne Nesenti said it directly was. Sana Amanat's idea of what a comic is and how it expresses itself is not a conflict at all. It is a de-escalation. Whereas Anne Nesenti said, no, it's an escalation narrative. Sana Amanat said, no, it's a de-escalation narrative. And that feeds right into what Ta-Nehisi Coates was saying. Ta-Nehisi Coates was specifically using these words. It's about de-escalation. Now, this is why these people, when they write these stories, destroy the idea of hero itself. Because again, if you have a hero and a villain, and your hero is a paragon of virtue, and your villain is steeped in vice, and these two things are mutually exclusive, it comes down to a conflict. But these people, these progressive people, who believe themselves to be the peacemakers, they see everything as coming down to de-escalation. And if you have a story which is supposed to, by nature of a hero itself, lead to an escalation, and what you are trying to force upon the story is nothing but de-escalation, then you destroy the entire notion of a hero, and certainly destroy any kind of hero narrative at all. Now, I want to explore that idea for a few minutes, according to Coates' own words. Why in their minds, and how in their minds, does everything lead to a de-escalation narrative? Well, first of all, let's talk about it in terms of a story. You have these progressive people, and they believe, because of their ideology, that something fundamentally untrue exists. They believe that reality is shaped by your subjective feelings. Now, anybody who has two cents to rub together knows that this simply is not true. But this is part and parcel of the narrative that the progressives tried to sell you. They tried to sell you the idea that you can define your gender, that you can define your age, that you can define your species by what you feel. That is to say, let's go with the most ridiculous of those, that you can define what species you are by how you feel, and that alters the reality of what species you actually are. So if you declare yourself through your feelings that you are a spirit unicorn, then that is actually what you are in reality. It is a statement that your feelings are shaping reality to your will. Now, briefly, this is wholly ridiculous. This is something that does not actually exist. And as I expressed in other videos, This is why these people take things like social programs and put them on steroids. Why? Because they're acting in a way that is directly contrary to reality, and in doing so, reality ain't gonna stand for it. And reality smacks them to the ground time and time and time again. And so they need to set up these giant social programs so that when these people do get smacked to the ground, A, they don't realize that it's reality that's actually smacking them to the ground, B, they get cushioned from this smack actually hitting them, and C, they get helped up as quickly as possible so they don't actually perceive what is going on. And so these people, they have taken these actual good programs that can have some use within your society, have taken them out of the realm of charity, that is to say, the original definition of charity, caritas, which is an act of love towards another. They've taken it out of that realm and moved it into a support system for a denial of reality itself. And that's what they do within reality. But within a story, this becomes flipped on its head. Because, of course, you have the writer, and the writer is the god of this universe, and they control the reality of everything within this universe. Therefore, you have these progressive characters, and they're acting in these progressive ways. And let's take the example again of conflict, the idea that they are peacemakers. Within reality, these people think they are the peacemakers, and think that they can impose this upon reality itself and the reality of human existence. But when they try to do that, the only thing that they bring about is conflict. But within a story, they have control over the rules of reality itself. Therefore, you have these progressive characters. They're acting in this progressive way. They are trying to be these progressive peacemakers. And they are allowed to be so because the writer bends and twists and warps the reality of the story around them in order for their actions to play out the way a progressive narrative actually says they play out. Once again, I briefly like to point out the fact that this negates the idea that these are stories themselves, because again, let's go back to Aristotle. Definition of a story is a representation of reality. And if you take that definition of Aristotle and apply it to story as if it were true, and we'll apply it because that's the way a story has proceeded for more than 2,000 years, these realities within these stories need to have the set rules that reality itself has, at the very least, the majority of the set rules. And if you have a reality that's bending and twisting and warping around this character so that there is no set rules whatsoever, it negates the idea that it actually is a story. So briefly, this explains why these stories look like they do. Why you read comics that have the stories that make no sense, first of all, and that lead to no conflict at all. If anything, you have stories where a preset conflict is already happening, and then you have the characters come in and try to de-escalate everything within the story. That's the narrative that these progressive writers are trying to present. The whole thing is based upon de-escalation. That's why you have things like fight scenes that aren't included in the actual story. One of the perfect examples of this for comics was X-23. You had story after story where you had the female Wolverine starting to get into a conflict. You would see her rush headlong into a fight. Then within the next panel, the fight would be completely over and she would be standing over the unconscious bodies of the people she had just defeated. Why? Because that entire conflict does not need to be there. It needs to be erased. And so they did. They erased it. They don't put it in there because the story is about de-escalation of conflict, not actually the conflict itself. And this affects everything. This is why you see food within these stories so much. Because not only is there a de-escalation for the characters, but there should be a de-escalation in the mind of the reader. I just did a recent book, which was New Mutants number 10. You had a story which had a bit of a conflict, and these New Mutant characters were trying to de-escalate the situation. And within this larger story, you had a completely different scene in a completely different place with two characters that had nothing to do with the story, and it was a food scene. Why? Because, of course, you have the reader, and they're dealing with this conflict, even though it's being de-escalated, supposedly, so they have to throw in the middle of this entire book a food scene in order to make these people who are reading the story feel more relaxed, feel like there is a de-escalation going on, because food is a neutral subject. It is a calming subject, and so they're trying to throw these things in there to calm the reader down, because it's all about de-escalation in the minds of the writer. Again, this is why you have the feminization of all the men in all of these books. Why you have Captain America constantly hanging his head in shame. Why you have characters who are usually really strong, muscular, masculine characters acting like simps. Why? Because it's about de-escalation. You gotta neuter them. So you have to show them visually as being someone who is feminized. Not actually a man, not actually someone who thrives on conflict because it will make them better. No, it has to be a female idea of, look, we don't want any conflict at all, so my body posture is going to reflect that. It even goes as far down as the colors that they are using for these books. There is no large contrast of colors anymore. There is no bright scene that pops. Why? Well, in part, it's because they don't want this large contrast between this and that. And it all leads down to this blending of everything together. The idea that there is no this and that. Everything can be the opposite of what it actually is if you just change it little by little into that. And the use of colors does this supremely well in these horrible looking books they have right now. But let's move on to why Ta-Nehisi Coates actually believes this and why the other progressive writers, I would say, believe this, not so much in the conscious way that Ta-Nehisi Coates does, but simply in a habitual way in the back of their minds. It is all about the idea that human nature is either A, good, or B, essentially nothing, so you can't call it bad. Now, within this interview, Coates himself actually states that. And he's talking to another person who is Ezra Klein, who works for Vox, and they are stating and agreeing that the old idea of Western civilization is that human nature fundamentally boils down to one of conflict and war, which, as I said in my last video, is untrue. You had people in the last couple of hundred years saying that, but that was ideological. That wasn't philosophical. Traditionally, philosophically, Western civilization simply states that human nature is broken, and that brokenness leads to disorder, and that disorder then can lead to conflict, but not that human nature itself fundamentally boils down to it being warlike. There is a big difference between those two things. But this is the straw man, of course, that these two men set up. The idea that Western civilization says that all human beings are fundamentally violent and warlike. And of course, they set up the straw man in order to support their own argument. And their own argument is to redefine what human nature actually is. Again, this redefinition of human nature is contrary to reality that we know about human beings and our entire history. Nowhere can you point to in our history anything that looks like human beings being fundamentally peaceful at heart, which is what they're trying to redefine human nature as being. Or at the very least, as I said, it being fundamentally nothing, which means that it can be brought into a peaceful state with nothing inhibiting it whatsoever. And again, this is not me putting words into their mouths. This is actually part of the conversation, if you go and read it, that they're talking about, is a redefinition in the minds of everyone within Western civilization about what the human nature of a human being is. And they want to make this redefinition of human nature because they want people to believe that human beings are, again, fundamentally, at heart, peaceful and ordered instead of conflicted and disordered. This, by the way, is the exact reason why they're calling for the complete defunding of the police and, in some cases, the military. Why? Because what they are saying, and what Coates is saying in this interview itself, he's stating that what you have within these institutions of police and military, it's all a systemic evil. It is all built upon the idea that human beings are fundamentally disordered and so conflicted. And so, since their entire existence is based upon this principle, when they show up prepared to deal with a disordered person, and therefore a conflict will ensue. And why will the conflict ensue? Well, the conflict will ensue because the police are actually provoking this conflict through showing up with this mindset and prepared according to this mindset. So when a police officer shows up with a uniform, when he shows up with a gun, when he shows up in riot gear, this is a provocation for violence, nothing else. And the provocation, again, comes from the idea that the entire notion of why they're showing up this way is the idea that the human being that they're going to deal with is fundamentally disordered, and therefore they will have to deal with this disorder and bring it back into some kind of order. And again, in Coates' own words, what this does is it backs these people into a corner, especially people of color, as he likes to say. Again, I hate using that term, but he uses it, so I'll use it for clarity. So what he's trying to describe is the fact that you have people, and in his estimation and the estimation of his ideology, these people, in their human nature, if they have one, are fundamentally ordered and good. And as such, when you have someone like a cop showing up in their neighborhood prepared upon the idea that people are not fundamentally good and they need to impose order upon them, this is a provocation for a violent reaction, because these cops are indeed trying to, by force, impose this idea upon everyone in their communities. They're trying to impose this idea, especially upon these people of color. Impose upon them the idea that, yes, you are fundamentally disordered and that needs to be dealt with. And if we have to deal with it by force, we will, and we will be prepared to do so. And again, Coates describes this as the police backing these people of color into a corner. And so what happens? If any violence ensues, it's justifiable, because what is happening is these people being backed into a corner, they lash out with, of course, emotion. And this lashing out of anger and emotion is a natural byproduct of the situation that is occurring, because they are being oppressed by this idea that is what built the cops to begin with. And so their solution for this is to get rid of cops and to replace them with these people who are basically social workers of different kinds. Because, of course, the entire idea is the fact that this escalation of what is happening within this person's life is because they were taken out of their fundamental human nature state of being ordered and good and peaceful and driven into an agitated state by some outside force. Because, of course, this has to be an outside force, something beyond themselves, which is controlling them, because if it didn't control them from an outside source, then they would be fundamentally good and ordered and peaceful. And so these social workers are supposed to show up because they are there to de-escalate the situation and bring this person back down to this ordered and peaceful state, because their ideology claims that either A, this is the essential part of human nature, or B, human nature is essentially nothing, and a human being can have a constructed human nature which is built by society, and so they can be molded and shaped into something that has this reflection of a human nature, although it is a construct. But of course, this entire thing is set up in a very specific way. This entire thing is based upon a narrative. Because these progressive people, with their progressive ideology, they know very well that their progressive ideology does not actually exist within reality. If you try to apply it to reality, it will fail, and it will always fail. So that's why they need to sell you a narrative. That is to say, they need to sell you a story where everything is changed around, the reality in the background is changed around in such a fundamental way that it makes it look like their ideology actually will play out within reality. This is why they love taking over anything that is connected to a story whatsoever. Because again, a story is a narrative, and they themselves are selling a narrative, and so they need to control all of the narratives in order to sell their story. And this, by the way, is also why they would rather see all of these industries die rather than to give them up. Because if they gave up these industries that tell stories, then they give up one of their fundamental tools to shape the narrative that they themselves need to sell to people to make it look like their ideology actually can exist within reality. Because again, let's go back to Aristotle. What is a story itself? Well, a story is a form of rhetorical argumentation. But the thing is that, as Aristotle himself admitted, as a argument, it is the easiest corrupted of all the argumentations. And this, again, is why these progressive people go after storytelling. Because they are presenting you an argument that their side is actually in the right. And it is a form of argument that is the most easily corruptible. So that's exactly what they do. They corrupt this form of argument in order to present you a false representation of reality so that you believe what is fundamentally a lie. And one of the biggest lies that they tell is what Coates himself is expressing within this article. He is claiming indirectly through his narrative that anyone who has an idea that is opposed to progressivism is someone who brings about violence and chaos. And those people who have this progressive ideology, who believe it unwaveringly, these are the people who are the peacemakers. Anyway, if I've given you anything new to think about, hit like, hit the shield in the lower right-hand corner of your screen to subscribe, and leave me a comment. Tell me what you think about all this. All right, I'll see you later. Bye.